All this, as I said, is just fated. I never thought anything about my being registered as a number one Polytechnic student. It never occurred to me that it would have been of some significance.
Hi, Mr. Lim. I'm Kenneth. I met you 5 years ago during my graduation. Do you remember?
Yes, of course I remember.
Yeah. Then we give each other a high five.
Five.
So you have some pictures to show me?
Yes, I just happened to go through some very old pictures. When the Polytechnic started the advertising course, that was in 1957. First classroom was at Hague Road Boys School. We went down there and we were all gathered downstairs in the open air. And until the caretaker of the school came and said, "Hey, your classroom today is so-and-so." And so we all went up to that class. In other words, we had no fixed classrooms. Oh, the lecturers were all of them from the advertising agencies. All of them were expatriate, except for one, Mr. Lim Bian Han, who was the Singapore printer. All were part-time students, all of us.
What do you think some of the facilities that you would like to have back then in those days?
Oh,
then
those days there are no such thing like this. So you are all very lucky. It's like being in luxury.
Definitely.
Yeah, I'm so happy to see that this all available for the students today. Maybe they don't realize how lucky they are. Polytechnic, when we started, it's not looked upon like as what it is now. If you failed in your elementary school, then you went to a trade school. There they teach you how to become a mechanic and all other trades, like carpentry and so on and so forth. You were encouraged in those days to join Polytechnic rather than the trade school because they were phasing out the trade school. So there was no glamour in joining Polytechnic. In fact, you felt a bit shy to say that you're a Polytechnic student. Today, the reverse is the case. You proudly say, "I'm a Polytechnic student." I went to school in 1930. Started school at Serangoon English School in Simon Road. I went to school by bus. In those days, they had seven-seater buses. It's commonly known as mosquito bus. There is a bench on the left side of the bus and a bench on the right side of the bus. And the cost for bus fare from Lim Tua Tau Road, that was near Yio Chu Kang Road, up to Simon Road, was only 3 cents. After that, as I said, the first 10 boys in the feeder school, like Serangoon, Rangoon Road, Geylang English School, Telok Kurau, Radin Mas, the first 10 pupils in the class, standard 5, were sent to Raffles. After Raffles Institution, I went to Pitman's College, actually, where I studied shorthand, typewriting, and just for the fun of it, I also enrolled for the London matriculation. But here again, I have nothing to show for it because I believe the exam papers never reached England because of the war. Yes.
How did it feel to get the chance to go back to school again?
After going through the experience of the war and the sufferings which the citizens endured, of course, the chance to better yourself was a great opportunity and something you relish.
Mm. So you were more hungry for knowledge back then?
I don't think the average person during my time bothered much about education. It was more a case of being able to make ends meet and to live a comfortable life. But nobody really bothered because there was no demand actually for a better educated person unless he wanted to become a lawyer or a doctor. When the college was opening, the intention was to go to college, but the manager of Nestle came to see me and said, I understand you're going back to college. I said, yes. So he said, why don't you throw in your lot with us? I said, okay, I'll join them. I joined them as a salesman with a salary of $110. And $30 high cost of living allowance, a total of $140. Then they sent me over to Penang as a Penang manager. So I became the first local Asian manager of Nestle. I worked there for 30 years. I love working. In fact, when I worked in Nestle, I never took a day's leave. So much so that they told me, you are not taking leave, but as far as we are concerned, we are recording you as taking leave. I'm a workaholic, I tell you honestly. The more work you give me, the happier I am. One day, when I was manager of Slita Country Club, Mr. Koo Kee Chai, who was the principal of Singapore Polytechnic, playing golf there, and we were chit-chatting. And then when he said he was Polytechnic, then I told him I was the first registered Polytechnic student. Next thing I knew was he rang me up and said, hey, Chinik, I think you better join the Graduates Guild. And I said, okay. And that's how I joined the Graduates Guild. And that's how I oversaw the building of the Singapore Graduates Guild down at Dendover Road. And they believed that because I contributed quite a lot towards the guild, they made me the first honorary member of the Polytechnic.
So we can see so much progress.
Yeah. As in all things, there's always a give and take. But having taken, I think it's time to give. So those who graduate today, I think, should be very grateful that they have been able to be where they are, to be who they are today. Take every opportunity now to give back in the way of encouraging those in school and telling them what they should do because they are young, they do not know what is ahead of them. So give them guidance in this respect so that it makes life easier for them.
This is the, I suppose it's a There's lesson a way of thanksgiving.
It should be. It's a way of life. I get invited to the graduation ceremony every year. Last significant one was when I was invited for the graduation ceremony for the 150,000 graduate. They asked me to stick around and make sure that I am around when they have the 200,000 students graduating. All this, as I said, is just fated. Just fated. I never thought anything about my being registered as a number one student. It never occurred to me that it would have been of some significance.